morning. How you feeling? How you feeling? How you feeling? It's breakfast with Bob.
And Poncho Man, of course.
Hello, thank you, Poncho. Everybody. Good morning.
You are the legend. Welcome to Breakfast from Kona, presented by Active, inspired to race is the hashtag. We are also sponsored by Timex, Rudy Project, GoPro, MPA Graphics, Lava Magazine, Babbittville Radio. Our next guest has 6 Ironman titles to his name. And last year, huge breakthrough, was second here in Kona, Mr. Luke McKenzie, wearing the coolest trucker hats on the planet. How you doing, Luke?
I'm great, Bob. I love being here in Kona. This is my favorite week of the year. And I'm just, you know, I'm really excited about coming back here and racing this year.
Well, I love the trucker hat. Last year, it's funny, it's almost like you've invented the trucker hat.
Well, I'd have to say that Julie Moss definitely invented the trucker hat in the triathlon circles. But yeah, no, I guess it's a hat that I feel very comfortable wearing when I'm racing. And, you know, it's really cool to see what we're able to do with it last year. So,
yeah.
You know, this year we've been able to help support CAF Foundation. Which
we love. Wait a second. What the
hell? So, yeah, no, that's just something that, it's great that we're able to, you know, do something good, cool with it. And, you know, we've been able to raise over $5,000 so far for CAF with the trucker hats. And we're not
just
even
this
at,
week.
We're not even at race day yet.
Yeah.
So it's way better than I even expected. So, you know, just to be able to do something cool like that, you know, I'm proud of that.
And, you know, when you win, just think. Yeah. Big number.
Where's the trucker hat going to
go from there? Yeah. Exactly. So it's interesting. I was looking at some of the, you know, your results over the last couple of years. Obviously, second last year. And what was interesting to me was how you've sort of reinvented yourself as a cyclist. Because a couple years ago, I think your RPM, when you were ninth here, your RPM was like in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
The following year, when you were 24th, mm-hmm. something like that, it was 73, 74. Mm-hmm. Then last year, it was up over 90, like
yep.
93.
Yep.
Was that a conscious effort? Okay, I've got to be able to run better,
yep.
so I've got to not load up my legs as much.
Yeah, I mean, in 2011, you know, I had a great bike ride here. I was able to get away with Marino, and that was the year that Crowley went on
right.
to break the record. And I had a really good bike ride, but I think coming back in 2012, I was trying to search too much and trying to overdo it. And I led the race quite early for a couple of hours, and I burnt way too many matches early. But I took that in as a big learning experience, and you know, I knew I had the ability to do that, and that was the way that I was going to win this race. So the focus last year really was based around my cycling and making sure I really can consolidate that strength.
Right.
And you know, that's what really set my race up last year. So you know, the last year or so has really been about making sure that my bike is my bomb-proof, you know.
Is your weapon.
It's my weapon, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't
want
to use that word, but yeah.
No, that's what it is,
yeah.
right? That's what you're trying to do. So when I look at the splits from last year, I mean, you and Freddie, the guy who won, are pretty much the same in a swim, and you had a couple minutes on a bike, and he picked up 6 minutes or so on the run. So this year, I'm assuming that the run was a focus as well. What's hard is if you focus on one, you can lose another.
Yeah, and that's something that I've been quite mindful of. You know, I know what got me to the result that I had last year, and it's been about not trying to change too much.
Yeah.
You know, I know I've got that run in me. You know, I've ran in the low 250s before in a few Ironman. So, you know, it's this year I've also dropped a little bit more weight. I feel like that's really helping in the back end of my
yeah.
marathon. I've focused a lot around strengthening my back end of my
right.
marathon. And, you know, I feel a bit more confident in my run this year. You know, last year I really focused on my riding and probably went into the race not really knowing where my run was. Whereas I feel like I've coming into the race, I feel like I've got a really strong run this year. So, yeah, I'm excited to see if, you know, I can piece it all together like I did last year.
Love it. So when you look back at just your metamorphosis as an Ironman guy over the years, talk a little bit about what it's taken in terms of dedication, because like you said, you lost some weight,
mm-hmm.
and that made a huge difference for last year.
Mm-hmm.
But there's also a fine line between getting too skinny and
yep.
losing your power on the bike. I think
mm-hmm.
I saw that years ago with
mm-hmm.
Thomas Elriegel. He yep. got so skinny for the run that his
mm-hmm.
bike went backwards.
Mm-hmm.
How tough a balance is that?
Yeah, I mean, it's like you said, like my career hasn't, you know, it's been a constant progression, and it's been about learning and coming here and trial and error. And I think, you know, I've had a good consistent progression here. You know, when I first came here, I was 54th and second behind McKeely.
Yeah.
And it's just been, you know, about coming back, building on everything that I've learned each year. And I think 2010 was probably a real important year for me because it was actually a year that the only year in the last eight that I haven't raced. So I qualified, but I had to pull out that year. And just sitting on the sidelines and watching the race and how it really panned out, it was definitely, you know, something that I took away coming into 2011 that really, you know, I was able to get that view from, you know, inside the race. You know, I was right up there behind Macca and Raylert in those last closing miles, and you know, that was really cool to see. But it was something that, you know, I made sure that I made good use of that day and took a lot away from it. So yeah, it's been about learning and making sure that, you know, you're constantly trying to better yourself.
So you led this race for a long time last year. Does it get to a point where you start taking ownership, where you're going, okay, I'm winning this race, this is going to be great, who am I going to thank in my acceptance speech? How far down the pike does it get, and how tough is it when all of a sudden Freddie goes by?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't get as far as writing acceptance speeches, but I tell you what, after I left Polani and I was on the way out, you know, out past Hinalani there, I thought, I got this, you know, like this is mine. And you know, that's the thing about this race is, you know, you can be feeling invincible 1 minute and then you can feel, you know, absolutely terrible and really suffering the next. And right. You know, I hit a low spot going into the energy lab, and you know, it was about hanging tough. You know, I got to the special needs aid station. I saw that I was in a podium position at the World Championships, and you know, I had to believe that, you know, I owned that position there. And you know, seeing Crowe as I left the energy lab, you know, that gave me a big spur on again. And
you know, did he say anything to you?
No, he did. He actually stopped and came across the road and he
really?
Said, "You're gonna have to suffer if you want to win." And so, you know, I took that on board, and you know, I made sure that I suffered all the way home. And you know, I didn't give up hope that, you know, I'd lost the race. You know, Freddie,
stuff happens,
and we've seen it time and time again.
Exactly.
At this race, it's a brutal race. The last 10 kilometers of this race, you just really want to keel over.
Exactly.
And just stop. And yeah, so it's just about, you know, persisting and making sure that you're suffering and you're suffering through it.
So you're a daddy now. You've got little Win.
Yeah.
How does that change your life?
Oh, it's been an amazing change in my life. It's, you know, coming home from training now, it has so much more meaning. You know, I look forward to getting home and seeing my daughter after a long, long training ride. And there's nothing better than, you know, just sharing all those little moments. You know, like Beth and I have been out here for a couple of weeks now, and we've just introduced her to swimming and just taking her for swims each day, and just her reaction to the water, and just to, you know, it's just cool to be part of that. And you know, I never thought I'd be a father, and to be one, I'm so stoked I am.
So last year you're coming down a lead drive and you're in second place, but still your greatest performance here. What were your thoughts, and what would it be like to come down first? Especially knowing the legacy, knowing Craig Alexander, Chris McCormick, you know, Greg Welch, Pete Jacobs, all the great Aussies who've won here before.
Oh, it's something that obviously I would dearly love to have on my resume. You know, I was so close last year, I could almost smell it. But you know, I think you've got to earn your stripes here, and I feel like, you know, this is my eighth appearance here, and I've done my time here. I've studied the race. I've learned from the best. It would mean a lot, you know, just to me, to my family, to everyone that's ever supported me at this race. You know, they've believed that I could do it, and you know, I almost did it last year, and I'd love to do them proud by coming down there first. That would just mean so much.
It's interesting, as a lot of people have been watching this and go, okay, Luke McKenzie started, I'm sure he got into triathlon and was making a really good living, and you know, he's done the Ironman a number of times, but people don't. Oh, what are you doing? There we go.
I'm on TV.
Yeah. Hey, thank you.
It's all good.
So they don't realize there were times where you and Craig Alexander are sleeping on air mattresses next to the train tracks in Solana Beach,
yeah,
trying to figure out, can I make a living doing this sport or not? Because when you leave Australia and decide to go to the U.S., it's not like I'll go there for the weekend. You're basically committing, right? You're 6 months at least away from home, away from family, trying to figure out if you can make a living doing this sport.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's what makes the Aussies tough. And people say, you know, how the Aussies, you know, done so well at this race. But I think, you know, those first years on the circuit over here, you know, living away from home, committing to a life in the States, and really living from paycheck to paycheck, you know, back in those days, it was tough, you know.
Yeah.
And I think that makes you want it a little bit more. I think it makes you work for it. And, you know, I look back with such fond memories of just struggling by in those early years, just trying to make a living in this sport. And, you know, I'm very fortunate that, you know, I'd make a good living in the sport now, but you got to remember where you came from as well. And I think that's something that I always try and appreciate, that, you know, it hasn't always been like that. It's been a long journey, but a fun one.
Well, and especially when you talk about how long the journey was, because back at Ironman Australia, you were the kid at, the 25-mile mark?
Yeah.
Handing out aid?
Yeah.
Right? And
yeah,
then just running in with Pauly Kirru every time he'd win that thing?
Yeah. Yeah, no, I mean, growing up around the Foster Ironman when I was a kid was, you know, pivotal in me ultimately getting here and my love for the sport. You know, I'd go out there and, you know, I'd see Pauly Kirru swimming at the Foster Aquatic Center, and, you know, I was a kid that knew all the stats, and, you know, it's pretty funny. I see Caden Lieto, Chris Lieto's son, around here, and I see so much of him in me when I was that age, you know, just, you know, so much respect and admiration for these guys that are at the top of the sport. And, you know, I just, you know, I'm so thankful to my parents for, they never really pushed me into the sport, but they definitely gave me the opportunity to have a love for it and set goals and to really aspire to be great. And I think, you know, they've been a very integral part of me coming here to Kona. And every year they're here supporting me. And, you know, I think that's something that, you know, I just really like to thank my parents.
How big a crowd do you have here? How many Lukettes?
Yeah, well, my parents, they started off coming in 2006. They came for 1 week.
Yes.
And then in 2007, I think maybe they decided that they were going to buy a timeshare or something. So then they came for 2 weeks. And then it's just progressed into this thing. And my parents are actually here longer than me now.
No, I think really? They live here. They're natives.
They love their annual vacation to Kona. And, you know, I really have to thank mum and dad, because, you know, they're, especially now Wynn's come along, you know, they're very readily available. You know, Beth just raced over in Malaysia last
week.
Did
really well.
And, you know, she did. We'll talk about that in a second, hopefully. But, and it was just, you know, I really have to thank my family. It's allowed Beth to get back into her racing, and it's allowed me to focus on what I need to do here as well.
Talk a little bit about what Beth did last week.
Yeah, she's amazing. What Beth's been able to do since...
being a mom, we're talking.
Being a mom, like... Yeah, no, you can't fathom like what she's been doing to actually get herself to the start line. She's been going out and doing 5-6 hour rides with a brick run, but breastfeeding in between that and looking after Wynn. And it's just, you know, constantly mind-boggling to me, you know, that she's been able to put it all together, because there's, you know, there has been sleepless nights for her. I mean, I have to say Beth has taken the reins in that regard. You know, I've really been allowed to focus on what I've needed to do for this race, and not only has she helped along the way with Wynn in every aspect, she's allowed me to do what I need to do for this race as well.
So when you come back from a bike ride and you're going, God, I didn't ride well, I come back for a run, and then all of a sudden you see your little one, it all melts away, right?
Oh, totally. You know, I mean, it's, we think about her so much when we're out there training, and, you know, we're very lucky that my sister's been traveling a bit with us this year. You know, she's been there to help us with Wynn, but, you know, we love and cherish those times between training sessions, you know, where we just get to have our family time, and it's really been the highlight of our day.
I love it. Luke, as always, thank you so much for taking time. Congrats on the hats.
Yeah.
I love these. We're talking, you've raised $5,000 already?
Yeah.
$5,000 already, and what's the goal?
Good question. I mean, I didn't really set a goal on it. You know, if we're up to five, you know, let's go for 10. So you can go onto lukemckenzie.com and find the link to the huts. It's going to the CAF Foundation, which Bob is obviously the founder of and heavily involved with. And I'm just proud to be able to support a local charity for me in San Diego. You know, like I've been saying to people, I see the CAF athletes out training, you know, around San Diego, and, you know, I have a bit of interaction with them. So it's, you know, it's just really cool to see that, you know, there's those, you know, as a professional athlete, I feel like what we do is our job. But for those guys to be able to finish races with those disabilities, you know, I have a lot of respect for that. And, you know, I'm glad that I can help support that.
Well, and you'll be with us next week at San Diego Triathlon Challenge.
I can't wait. It was a real highlight of mine last year. I did the swim leg. This year, I think I'm doing the bike leg. I'm not going to jump in La Jolla Cove this year and have a swim. I've decided I want to get out on the bike and just be a bit more amongst it that way. So I'm really looking forward to that event. It's a fun day and I can't wait.
It's pretty interesting when you see 150 different challenge athletes all in one place with every challenge there is, mate, and nothing gets in their way.
You leave there with absolutely zero excuses. You know, you see what some of these people have been able to overcome, and what you know, it's such an inspiring day. I'm really, you know, I would say if you can get down to La Jolla and watch it, because it's the most inspiring day that you'll be a part of.
Well, thanks, Luke. I appreciate it. Luke McKenzie has been our guest. Poncho Man. This is Breakfast from Kona. We're presented by Active. Inspired to race is the hashtag. Brought to you by Timex, Rudy Project, GoPro. We've got our GoPro 4 right there. Two camera shoot. MPA Graphics, Lava Magazine, Babbittville Radio. Poncho Man, take us away.
Who can it be knocking at my door? Go away. Don't come around here no more. Breakfast with Bob. Breakfast with Bob.
Poncho Man, everybody!
Oh!
Yeah!
Did a minute work for you?
We even had a photo bomb. I love it.